Welcome everyone to this, the seventh meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in 2017. To remind members and others in the room to switch phones and other devices to silent. We've received apologies from Maurice Corey, MSP, and to substitute today is Edward Mountain, MSP, so welcome to you. Can we move to agenda item number one on continued petitions? First item is consideration of three continued petitions. We will hear evidence on each of the petitions from the Deputy First Minister, and we're grateful to him and his officials for attending this morning's meeting. The first petition is petition 1548 on national guidance on restraint and seclusion in schools, lodged by Beth Morrison. Members have copies of correspondence from Dr. Brodie Patterson, the Deputy First Minister, and two submissions from the petitioner. The Deputy First Minister is accompanied by Laura Meikle, team leader, and Melanie Lowe, Relationships and Behaviour in Schools Policy Officer. And as we have limited time this morning, we will move straight to questions from the committee. So can I welcome you, Mr. Swinney? And maybe can I start off with a question about the communications passport, which obviously is covered in your correspondence to us. You say that this will be signposted in Included, Engaged and Involved too, and will be part of a suite of documents to support schools and local authorities with implementation of the IE12. The petitioner notes that you've indicated the resource will be rolled out via the GLOW network. Can we just ask, what is the timescale for the passport and other documents being published?
The passport material can be available readily on the GLOW site, and this is, I think, a very important development that's been taken forward by, was referred to by the petitioner, but it's also been taken forward very significantly by one of my own constituents, Mrs. Kate Sanger, on behalf of her own daughter, and I have had the pleasure of dealing with Mrs. Sanger in relation to the support of her own daughter, and I have a copy of her communication passport here, which I think is a really fabulous piece of work that Mrs. Sanger and her daughter Jennifer have put together on behalf of Laura Sanger, and it really does represent a powerful resource to be used by anyone who is involved in the support of Laura. And as a model, the communications passport, I think, offers a very clear way of advising individuals about how they can best support Laura in her needs. In addition to the communications passport tool being available on the GLOW website, I've also asked Mrs. Sanger and also Mrs. Morrison, the petitioner, if they would discuss the communications passport with a gathering of senior officials from the Advisory Group on Additional Support for Learning, which is a Scottish Government group that's convened by Jan Savage from Enable. And that brings together representatives of COSLA, the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, representatives of Education Scotland, and all the relevant bodies who would be responsible for putting in place the guidance and also enabling the use of tools like a communication passport within our system. So I want Mrs. Morrison and Mrs. Sanger to have the opportunity face to face with those bodies that will either be the enablers or the inhibitors to the communication passport being widely understood and utilised within our education system, to have that opportunity face to face to explain the rationale behind the communications passport and to encourage participation and utilisation of such a tool within the education system. And I expect that meeting to take place on the 30th of August. Okay,
thanks very much for that. Is there an issue about not just the passport existing, but staff being aware of it, given the nature of some of the staff who may be supporting a young person? It's not necessarily just teaching staff, but other support staff. Are there measures put in place to allow people the time to be able to actually reflect on what a communications passport is telling them?
I think that's my rationale for... I don't think it's just enough, for example, to put this tool up on the GLOW, on the GLOW website and say, well, there, it's there, it's a great resource to use. I think that helps, because obviously that means there is access to this type of material on a widespread basis throughout our education system, but also through the care and support system as well. But in addition to that, I think it's really important that we have very active promotion of the attributes of the communication passport, because I think, Convener, you raise a fair point, which is the value of a passport of this type is only if it has an influence on the practice and the behaviour and the actions of members of staff, that they have enough time to consume the details of that and to understand its significance. So the gathering that I talked about there is important to provide that platform for the petitioner and for Mrs. Sanger to explain the attributes and the benefits of the communication passport. But it's also really important that the communication passport becomes part of the normal way of working to make sure that we support young people with additional support needs. And within that, they're obviously, you know, if I look at the passport I referred to earlier from Laura, there's a lot of detail in here, but it's important detail to be understood and to be followed. And by understanding that detail, members of staff of whatever discipline they come from will be better equipped to support individuals in meeting their needs if they have an opportunity to understand and follow the material that's within the communications passport and then reflect that in the practice that they take forward.
Thanks, Angus McDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister. In your submission, you also say that you'll consider a refresh of the child protection guidance following implementation of the recommendations of the Child Protection Improvement Programme. As with the communication passport, I'm interested in the timescale of this work to be completed. Could you outline that to the committee and the expected conclusion of that programme? And can you give an indication of when you would expect the recommendations to be implemented?
As first of all, in relation to the refreshed guidance, which will be set out, it will be published within the context of the school exclusion guidance, but the purpose of the guidance is to address the issues that have been raised in the petition from a perspective of encouraging positive behaviour. So although the material will be under the umbrella of school exclusion guidance, the thinking and the rationale within the guidance is all about encouraging positive relationships and positive behaviour. And that guidance I expect to publish by the end of May. It's taken quite a bit of time to get to this point because I think it's fair to say we've not had unanimity that this was the right thing to do. We've had to work quite hard to persuade a variety of different bodies of the advantage of this approach, but I'm now satisfied that the guidance that we have developed has been considered by the Sagrabus group with which the committee will be familiar, and I feel confident to be in a position to publish that in the end of May. And obviously I want to hold off to hear if there's anything else the committee wishes to say to me about these issues as a consequence of my attendance here today. On the wider issues in relation to the Child Protection Improvement Programme, as the committee will be aware, the government is taking forward a number of strands to ensure that we can be confident our child protection programme is appropriate and effective in meeting the needs of children in Scotland in the current environment. We received before Christmas the report from Catherine Dyer, which essentially looked at, if I might describe it, as the structural and procedural design of the child protection programme. And the report from Catherine Dyer essentially validated the procedures and the processes of the Child Improvement Programme, but challenged us quite significantly on questions of ensuring that leadership was effective in the delivery of that programme. And Mr. MacDonald, when he made a statement to Parliament earlier on this year, made it clear that that will be the early focus of our work to strengthen the child protection programme, to make sure that we honour the recommendations and address the recommendations that were put in front of the government by Catherine Dyer. I would expect that the updated guidance on the child protection programme would probably not be available until 2018, given the work that we have to do to strengthen the leadership elements of the programme. But that will be, I'll obviously be happy to advise the committee on the progress that we make in that respect.
Thank you.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you. Good morning, First Minister. Looking at the drafting of the guidance on the use of restraint and physical intervention, the petitioner has commented she's concerned that this has been treated as an education issue rather than a learning disability issue within an education environment. She's also suggested that some experts in this field offered assistance in drafting the guidance, but that these offers were declined. I wonder if you could respond to those comments and to outline how you've ensured that the relevant expertise has been drawn in to develop the guidance.
The first thing I'd say is that we've consulted extensively with a wide variety of stakeholders who are involved in this field of activity, principally around the activities of the SIGRABIS group, which is chaired jointly between the government and the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities. And as I indicated in my response to the convener a moment ago, there hasn't been unanimity about the taking forward of this agenda, and we've had to work very carefully to create that unanimity and to structure the guidance in the way that it is now structured. So that has involved extensive stakeholder involvement to make sure that we had in place all of the necessary attributes. And what that's resulted in is the development of a guidance document which is essentially tries to take a proactive and preventative approach to the whole issue of addressing how one might consider the issue of physical restraint. And a lot of that approach is, and that preventative, proactive approach is epitomised by the thinking that has gone into the communications passport that I referred to earlier on, where we are encouraging, the guidance is predicated on trying to avoid these situations materialising. So the emphasis and the procedure and the process is all emphasising the need to try to create avoidance approaches based on positive relationships and positive understanding of the needs of individuals. And the communications passport, I think, is a really important tool in ensuring that can be the case. The advice is predicated on the importance of recognising the knowledge that staff have and the detail of the assessment that they have of the child or young person is vital to predict and to plan for the type of situation that may cause any stress or frustration that can lead to challenging or distressed behaviour. So it's about actually acknowledging the importance of planning situations and planning approaches which try to ensure avoidance. But then where the communications passport is really helpful is that it advertises what will be the signals of distressed behaviour, so that when those very early signals can be identified, there can be steps taken to try to reduce the stress and the difficulty that is created. So the guidance is predicated on that preventative, proactive approach and presents any question of physical restraint as an absolute last resort, which should only be considered when there is risk of physical harm being undertaken as a consequence. And I think the wording of the guidance, we've gone to great lengths to try to ensure that character comes through the wording of the guidance. And that essentially brings me on to the other point that Rona Mackay raises with me, which is about the concern expressed by the petitioner that this is being considered as an education issue. I'd like to assure the committee, and I hope what I've my explanation in getting to this part of my answer is designed to address the fact that that has not been the way the government has approached this. I obviously respect the fact that individuals will have to come to a judgment about that when they see the guidance, but my thinking and the thinking my officials have taken forward in this respect has been about trying to take that proactive preventative approach to equip individuals with knowledge and understanding beforehand to try to avoid situations materialising. And that requires, that can't be just a narrow educational view, that has to be a whole person approach that is taken. And I hope that is clear from individuals looking at the guidance that the government publishes at the end of May.
Thank you.
Good morning,
Swinney.
Good morning. Just wondered if you'd help me, as far as the guidance is concerned and the document that you're talking about, how do you see that being promulgated down to the people who actually are going to have to deal with it? Because I know avoidance should always be the first call, but in the case where, for example, my wife was a classroom assistant and was assaulted, she was unclear when the situation flared up how to actually respond. Although she had been given guidance, it's very difficult sometimes to remember the guidance. So will there be training undertaken to ensure that the guidance is promulgated down to all those who need to know it?
As Mr. Mountain will be familiar, there will be a number of levels of communication required to make sure this message can be received. Once the government publishes this, the guidance will essentially be there for local authorities to take forward. And as the principal organisations, operating facilities in which these policies will need to be put into practice, it will be for local authorities to ensure that staff are adequately and appropriately trained to ensure that that is the case. Now, obviously, there will be particular environments within our education system where some of the issues that will be associated with this guidance will be much more prominent, and there will be then circumstances, perhaps in the ones that Mr. Mountain's wife faced, of a more isolated nature where knowing this guidance inside out is not going to be at the top of the training programme list of priorities. And we have to make sure that staff put in this situation are able to be aware of the guidance and to be able to have the necessary support available to them through leadership within the education system and through training to ensure that staff can be properly and effectively supported.
Thank you.
Brian Butchell.
Good morning, Deputy First Minister.
Good morning.
The petitioner has highlighted the UNCRC recommendation for the development of a national recording system and observed that in a response you have stated that details on how this should be undertaken should be included in the local authority's policy on de-escalation, physical intervention and restraint. I understand the petitioner would welcome clarity on what this means and how the inclusion of those details in a local authority policy would comply with the recommendation for the development of a national system, and I wonder if you care to respond to that point.
This point gets to, I think, quite an important issue about how we respond to calls from the UNCRC and reflect the type of system that we operate. As the committee and Mr. Whittle will know, local authorities have the responsibility to deliver our education services at a local level. And I often face the question, I face it on a regular basis, about what degree of intervention the government should have in that delivery. And this is one of those issues where essentially the local authorities have that responsibility, and then I come along and say, well, look, I want to monitor you to another extent in this respect. I quite understand why the UNCRC asked for that to be compiled at a national level, but our system is fundamentally a decentralised education system within Scotland where our local authorities have that operational role. So the way I've considered this is to essentially ask our local authorities as part of the guidance to undertake that recording of information. Obviously, we can gather that from local authorities, but I think it makes the most practical sense to respect and reflect that the character of our own system in how we respond to that call from the UNCRC.
Thank you. If I could further ask, on the issue of local authorities' policy, will the guidance provide a clear framework or mechanism of how policy should be developed, and whether the guidance will outline a role for the Scottish Government in ensuring any framework is followed?
Again, I suppose my answer is quite similar in that respect. The guidance, I think, is sufficiently clear to set out to local authorities what we would expect to see in that guidance. And some of the detail that I went through in my answer to Rona Mackay about that fundamental reliance on a proactive, preventative approach of understanding the young person to make sure they can be properly supported, therefore to enable us to avoid situations like this developing, is at the heart of the nature of the advice that we are setting out and the guidance that we're putting forward. And obviously, we would look to see local authorities reflecting that. Education Scotland have a responsibility to carry out the inspection of our education system, and obviously this will be one of the issues that Education Scotland will look at, as to how this policy has been formulated and applied at local level to make sure that the aspirations set out in government guidance are being followed at local level. Now, clearly, if we find a situation, if we come back in a couple of years' time and find that we really haven't made the progress that we all would like to see being made here and the guidance followed, then obviously the government can take further action if that is necessary. But I would rather operate on the basis that the government is promulgating this guidance, and as a consequence we are looking to local authorities to turn that into practical reality. But if we find that's not the case, then obviously the government will have to take account of that in the actions that we take in future periods.
Thank you.
If I can maybe just highlight, in Dr. Patterson and his evidence, I think the evidence from the petitioner and Dr. Patterson are quite strong in underlining their concerns with these questions. He says that a significant number of authorities continue to have no such policies. The petitioner has also commented in a recent BBC Five Live investigation on the use of restraint and seclusion in special schools, which found that in 37 of the UK's 207 local council areas, there were 13,000 restraints used, with over 700 injuries caused to children as a result of restraint. And the petitioner notes that the true figure across the UK is not reflected, given the number of authorities that are not included in the small number of authorities that actually responded to the FOI requests. And it's really to go back again to this question of the balance between the role of government and the responsibilities of local authorities. Would you consider it, you know, imposing a requirement on local authorities to develop a policy on this issue, and will they require to report annually to the Scottish Government? Is that something that you would consider?
I think some of my response to that, convener, relates to what I've just said to Brian Whittle, that we've embarked on the approach of setting out national guidance and therefore requiring local authorities to take forward guidance of their own to be reflected in their own provision. And we've done that essentially to take forward what I would characterise as a voluntary route in this respect, so that we're not putting this in statute. We're encouraging and motivating good practice in this respect. But I have to say that if we come back in a period and find that this has not been successful, then I would have to consider other options. So yes, in response to your question, I would have to be open to considering other greater requirements if I found that this was not resulting in the formulation of guidance at local level which reflected the guidance that has been agreed by SEGRABIS. And of course, SEGRABIS involves the government, local authorities, the Association of Directors of Education. So I'm trying to take people with me as I embark on this agenda. But if we find in due course that that's not been effective, then, you know, of course I will consider whether or not a greater obligation, perhaps of statutory force, is required to put this into practice.
The test of effectiveness, whether there are policies and guidance developed or whether there's a transparency around reporting on incidents.
Transparency and reporting on incidents, and also the feedback from members of the public as to whether parents and carers of young people feel that what I am saying here is reflected in what they are experiencing in different settings around the country. And if that's not what members of the public experience, then, you know, I have to accept that I have to come back here and do something different if that's not reflected in what they experience.
How you see that channel of communication from the public to yourself working? I mean, there's individual constituency cases, there's the petitioner. There is this concern that this is not just an education matter, it's about the expertise of people dealing with young people with learning disabilities. And I think you've made an offer which I'm sure would be welcome in terms of engaging and involving the petitioner and your own constituent. Is there something more formal around the organisations that properly understand learning disability around this issue? I think you mentioned earlier a group that's been brought together. I wonder if that is the vehicle by which this gap between what you hope is happening and what may be happening and how you then deal with that kind of information loop can be closed.
I think that would undoubtedly be within my view of how this needs to be taken forward, convener. I made reference earlier on to the event which I intend to ensure Mrs Morrison and Mrs Sanger are able to explain the communications passport to, and that's the Scottish Government Advisory Group on Additional Support for Learning. And that's chaired by Jan Savage from Enable. It brings together a range of key stakeholders, including COSLA and ADES, but other organisations who can be the conduit for the information that you talk about, convener, about established practice. And I would be looking to that group to be giving the government advice on how this is proceeding and how it is being experienced at local level. Now, as you'll be aware, convener, from the discussions that we've had separately at the Education and Skills Committee, where the committee has taken a very strong interest in the arrangements for additional support for learning, I expect there to be quite considerable more dialogue with that committee on many of these issues, and I would obviously be very keen to make sure that we respond positively to any flow of information that suggests that the guidance is not having the effect that I'm suggesting to the committee I think it may or it should be able to have.
Okay, thanks. Rona Mackay.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask you about the issue of seclusion. The petitioner and Dr. Patterson appear to be particularly concerned about the suggestion that the term seclusion might be replaced in the guidance by a term such as supported separation, with the effect of allowing seclusion rooms to remain. This is in the context of the UNCRC recommendation to abolish the use of isolation rooms. Can you respond to these concerns and explain whether supported separation would allow seclusion rooms to be used?
I think there is the possibility that seclusion may have to be used as a very last resort in such circumstances, but what the guidance will do is set out, firstly, that should be absolutely a last resort. It will set out, secondly, that must be with support and supervision, but it must be part of a plan that has been proactively considered to be utilised in certain circumstances, should those circumstances prevail. So it shouldn't be used as a form of punishment. That would be wholly and utterly unacceptable. But there may be an argument for it to be used as part of a plan to properly provide safety and security for individuals concerned. But it should only be used on those terms as a last resort and as part of a plan, and never be used as a form of physical punishment or punishment of any form.
Okay, thank you.
I wonder though if you accept that the UNCR recommendation is pretty clear, that isolation rooms should be abolished, and simply recasting them as seclusion rooms doesn't deal with the fact that they have, and I think the petitioner and Dr. Patterson are quite explicit in this too, that simply changing the words doesn't address the question that UNCR recommendations is asking us to address, which is these rooms shouldn't exist. So even as a last resort, they simply say they shouldn't be there.
I would want to assure the committee that I'm not sitting here having a play on words about this. And I'm not using terminology to try to perpetuate an existing practice. I'm trying to explain how there may be circumstances as part of a considered approach to de-escalating a situation that may emerge, that a period of supported time, which is quiet time, is defined within a plan, can be utilised in an effective way to de-escalate a situation. But I stress some of the fundamentals of my answer to Rona Mackay. That should never be viewed as a punishment, and it should never be presented or positioned as a punishment. And it should be only as part of a proactively considered plan about techniques that may be necessary to de-escalate a situation, but it should never be on the basis of personal isolation. It must be on the basis of support to assist in the de-escalation of a situation.
But do you accept that there is a problem there, though, that the danger is, I mean, how would it look different? Would it be a separate room? Is there an issue around the environment? I think some of the evidence says, you know, that sort of the physical characteristics of the room can sometimes cause greater distress to the young person. So it wouldn't be removing somebody to a physical space, but it would be they would be with a member of staff. I'm not sure. I mean, you understand the cynicism of people who think basically delete isolation, insert seclusion, and then we deal with the question of UNCR. But they are quite explicit about their desire for these rooms to be abolished.
When I, as I said earlier on, I've met Mrs. Sanger, who's produced the communications passport, on numerous occasions as a constituent of my own. But I've also met Mrs. Sanger with Mrs. Morrison, the petitioner, and Mrs. Morrison has shown me pictures of what I suppose might be described as isolation rooms, which I would judge to be wholly and totally unacceptable to be utilised. So when I talk about the need for, as a last resort, for seclusion, I'm talking about a separate room or a safe space which is defined and deemed to be appropriate to help to de-escalate that situation. So it couldn't be taking a young person to any old room. It would have to be to a particular space where a situation could be de-escalated with support from a member of staff, as part of a plan which would recognise this to be an issue of the last resort. It's simply to recognise that there may be issues of safety for the young person or for other members of staff that have to be considered at that time. So I don't want in any way to convey the impression that the guidance gives encouragement to the use of seclusion, but the guidance essentially recognises the fact that in certain circumstances there may be a need to de-escalate the situation, but it has to be done as part of a planned, supported approach in appropriate in accommodation that is appropriate. And some of the images I have seen of accommodation that has been used historically, I would judge to be utterly inappropriate. And the guidance would essentially make that point clear as part of this process.
Whose job is it to deem whether it's appropriate or not?
That would have to be undertaken by those making the assessment of what are the appropriate care needs for individuals, which will be undertaken at local level within the context of the judgments been made about what is appropriate to support an individual in meeting their needs. And again, that I come back to that wider assessment that has to be made of the needs of individuals and the requirement to ensure those needs are properly met within the system.
Thank you. I apologise, Deputy First Minister. I know you've alluded to some of this already, but I suppose my question is that with the effectiveness of the policy and the outcomes, and as you alluded to before, any required adaptations of the policy going forward, we'll come down to the measurement resource really that's put in place and implemented. And I wonder if there's a specific requirement from government that ensures that proper measurement of the policy's effectiveness going forward will be required.
I think that relies, first of all, on the quality of information gathering and reporting that's undertaken at local level. You know, that's where the data will be generated, and it's important that as a consequence of the application of the guidance, that data is collected effectively at local level. What we then do with that information gets into, I suppose, the discussion about whether this guidance has been effective in meeting the expectations that were contained within it, within the government's intentions in responding to this petition. And some of that will emerge from inspections undertaken by Education Scotland and by us determining whether or not the proactive approach has led to a lower incidence of reported events, which is what we would like to see emerging out of this, the application of this guidance. I don't think the reporting of this needs to be, but the reporting of this needs to be undertaken to ensure that we have a picture of whether the policy approach we're taking is being effective or not, and that it's leading to good practice at local level. And obviously, if we find that that's not the case, then we will have to come back and revisit some of these issues.
Will you be looking for a sort of uniformity of data gathering across councils?
Certainly to have a consistency across local authorities, yes.
Okay.
Can I just ask one maybe final point to go back to this question about who's responsible for deeming something to be appropriate in terms of seclusion, isolation rooms? Clearly, some of these spaces have already been deemed to be appropriate by people who've been responsible for supporting a young person or put them into a space that parents have regarded as inappropriate. So in terms of progress in this question, would you see there being parental involvement in defining what is acceptable around seclusion, as opposed to the abolition of isolation rooms?
I think the first thing I'd say, Convener, is that if we go back to the point that I've made myself, that I've seen photographs of a seclusion rooms which I would judge not to be appropriate, I have to accept that practice has not been appropriate so far. And if I accept that, then other people have got to accept that as well within the system. So the one of the purposes of the guidance is to improve practice and to make sure that as a consequence of taking this step to issue this guidance, we are actually improving practice at local level, and that the guidance gives pause for thought to improve and strengthen that provision. The second point I would say is to come back to one of the fundamental points of my evidence to the committee today, which I think is central to this whole discussion, and that is that there must be considered, careful preparation of the support arrangements for any young person who has additional support needs. And that process, in any shape or form to be good practice, must involve parents and carers in that process. So any organisation that is formulating a plan to support, if I just take this as an example, the communication passport that my constituent, Mrs Sanger, has put in place, what organisation would not take this seriously? Because it's been devotedly put together with quality and depth of information. Why would that not be embraced by an organisation to say, this is a fabulous resource to help us understand how we can best support Laura in her needs? And then when it comes to, and as part of that, as one looks at the the difficult territory they might get in, where situations will escalate, having parental involvement in identifying how a situation might be de-escalated would be crucial information to assist a provider in making sure they could do that satisfactorily. So parental involvement, I think, is crucial, and parental and carer involvement in that process is absolutely crucial. And finally, I think the importance cannot be understated of us being on a journey to improve practice. And the guidance is designed to help that and to encourage more and more. And there are many examples of this around the country where there are thoughtful, careful preparation of plans to support young people to ensure their needs are met. And that's, you know, it's an essential part of the system that we have in place. And if I, and you know, members of the committee will have heard me, they've heard other ministers, talking about the importance we attach to the arguments around, or the policy principle of getting it right for every child or young person, we have to make sure that's followed through in practice by the provision that's put in place. And if it's not, then we have to be open to being challenged about exactly that.
Thank you very much. I think that's all our questions. And in terms of taking this forward, I wonder if people have any comments on what we would want to do as a committee. It may be an opportunity for us to reflect on the Deputy First Minister's evidence, and perhaps the clerks can produce a note which we would consider at a future public meeting of the Petitions Committee. I think there's lots and lots of there food for thought there around both the evidence we've heard today and also obviously the comments that have been made by petitioners and others. Would that be acceptable? Okay.
Can I just add one other point, Convener, which is that obviously I intend to publish the guidance at the end of May, but I would want to have the opportunity to reflect on any thinking from the committee before I take that final decision. So if the committee, I'm anxious to make progress on publishing this guidance. So if the committee was able to provide me with its thoughts reasonably soon, it would give me the opportunity to reflect on that and to see if the guidance needs to change any further to reflect the issues that the committee wishes to raise with me.
I think we would want to respond very positively to that offer, and that is very helpful and important, I think, not so much for the committee but for the petitioner, who has obviously been persistent in this question for such a long time, and I think has in her own comments made the point that there has been progress and has welcomed the engagement with the Scottish Government in the matter.
And if it would help for the committee to have sight of the draft guidance as it is, as it stands today, I'd be happy to provide that to the clerks for the committee to reflect on if it wished that.
That would be very useful indeed. So I think there's quite a number of things we want to take forward from that. But can I thank the Minister for his response to this petition? Can I suspend briefly for the change of Scottish Government officials? Call the meeting back to order, and we now move to the next petition, which is petition 1581 on Save Scotland School Libraries. The petition was lodged by Duncan Wright on behalf of Save Scotland School Libraries. Copies of the most recent correspondence from COSLA, the petitioner and the Deputy First Minister have been circulated with the clerk's note on this petition. Accompanying the Deputy First Minister for this evidence session is Craig Flunkert, Team Leader for Skills, Literacy, Numeracy and Parents, and Katriona Mackenzie, Policy Manager. Again, to make the most of our time this morning, we'll move straight to questions from the committee. And maybe I can open up the questioning. Your submission notes, Deputy First Minister, that libraries, both school and public, have a key role to play in supporting Scottish Government initiatives. The initiatives referenced have a particular focus in early years. In an earlier submission, reference was made to the National Strategy for Public Libraries developed by the Scottish Library Information Council. That submission stated, quote, "It's important that school libraries continue to adapt to the needs of their users and the wider attainment aims of their schools." Given the recognition of the importance of school libraries, why should there not be a specific national strategy developed for school libraries?
I first of all want to say, Convener, that I acknowledge and strongly support the provision of school libraries, and I think it's an important part of the work that we undertake in encouraging an appreciation of literacy and literature amongst young people. I don't think there's unanimity on the need to have a national strategy, but I think the petitioner makes a fair point of the importance of having such an approach, and it would be my intention to formulate such a strategy.
Okay, thank you. Angus McDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. In your submission on the 13th of April, you referred to how good is our school for, and confirm that Education Scotland will be integrating the new librarian-focused guidance into the main framework. And you go on to state that this will give it greater prominence and help demonstrate the fundamental and wide-ranging links between the school library and the school's broader aims of on curriculum for excellence. Could you tell us when this is likely to be published and give us an indication at this time of the content of it?
I would want to have it in place for the start of the 2017-18 school year, so that would be by August of this year, and to ensure that that reflects the kind of key elements that we need to encourage through school libraries, which is about a combination of using school libraries to encourage literacy within learning and to encourage a general appreciation of the value, the social value and personal pleasure of appreciating literature. And obviously that fits in very comfortably with some of the wider policy objectives and approaches the government takes, principally through the recently launched but very comprehensively participated in First Minister's Reading Challenge, which is attracting significant participation around the country. And obviously the approach will also ensure that we're equipping young people through the wider work of Curriculum for Excellence to be conversant with information literacy as well, which we see as an important function and responsibility of school libraries within the wider school system.
Thank you.
You say information, what phrase you used?
Information literacy.
I'm old enough to remember when libraries were, you learned all about, I can't even remember what it's called now, but the system of the way in which you organise stuff to get information, encyclopedias, rather than just Googling it, having your daughter contradicting you in front of the television because you can Google it on her phone. Do you think...
It's a pleasure for us all.
Generally those skills around assessing information, where it comes from, that is something that libraries should be doing that's been lost as a skill?
I think there's a we had a very interesting conversation at the International Council of Education Advisors with Pasi Salberg from Finland, who is looking very carefully at, well, frankly, the impact of Googling everything in the learning process. And I think it's a fascinating area of inquiry. I'm old enough, convener, to remember preparing my university work, where you had to stand at long drawers of index cards working your way through. If I was to explain this to my children, they would look at me as if I was from the Stone Age compared to what they have access to. But, you know, those skills and are, I think, really important skills because it allows you to assess the value you should apply to what you find out from particular sources. And I think that's a challenge that is... that's not immediately obvious to individuals when they're just Googling something and getting whatever it throws up. So I think those skills are important skills, and I think libraries provide an opportunity for an appreciation of that to be undertaken. But there will be, as you'll be familiar, Kavira, within some of the wider areas of our education system, the development of research techniques which enable young people to acquire those skills and that knowledge are an important part of our education process.
If you accept that part of the concerns underpinning some of this petition is that lack of appreciation of that role of libraries, it's not just about accessing books and understanding a joy of reading, it's this other bit, and that may be the bit that they're particularly fearful that we're losing.
That was why I used the term information literacy to cover exactly that point, Convener, because I totally accept the point.
Thank you, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Another issue that's been mentioned in consideration of this petition is the role of not just libraries, but also of professionally qualified staff within the libraries, and the role that these staff play in enabling achievement of educational outcomes. Some concerns have been expressed that local authorities don't fully recognise this. I wonder if I could have your view on that.
I think it's difficult for me to generalise in this respect, because if I cite one anecdotal piece of evidence, a few months ago in February, I was visiting Elgin Academy, and when I went into the school, the head teacher said to me, "The first place we're going to go to is a library," and we. First time I've gone to a school visit and the first place we've gone to has been the library. So it's quite a different experience. And I went in there, and of course it was precisely designed to make a point to me by the head teacher that there was a professionally trained librarian who was a very, very motivated, driven individual who had transformed the library into essentially the epicentre of many other aspects of the school, which took into account, you know, some of the issues I was raising earlier on about an appreciation of literature and an understanding of information literacy, but also a place of contact, friendship, dialogue, reassurance. So it was actually, when you get into some of the thinking about how do our schools represent a safe, welcoming environment, if any child in the Elgin Academy was feeling a wee bit lost, the library would be a place of, where it was a hub of activity, where there was paired reading between older pupils and younger pupils, and various escapades of acting out literary works going on an ongoing basis, various projects and challenges been taken forward. So it was actually a hub of activity that for isolated young people would provide them with a place to go and to find some, and to have a good experience. So I think the professional strength of what librarians can offer is, a really important part of the process. But it's difficult for me to give a general view in response to the question of appreciation of libraries, because obviously there's an example, a very good example in my view, of the role of school libraries, and it will exist, and that practice will exist in a range of other examples around the country.
Okay, thank you.
Ryan Whittle.
Thank you, Kavina. Your most recent submission states that you would expect all local authorities to give careful and positive consideration of the future role of libraries, given their statutory responsibilities for the delivery of education and ensuring that there is an adequate provision of library services for their residents. Is there a mechanism for determining what amounts to adequate provision? And if not, what would the Scottish Government's view on the minimum service that could be considered as an adequate provision?
I think Mr. Puth and I are constantly, certainly this session, we're constantly talking about this interrelationship between government and local authorities, and it is I don't say that to diminish the point. It's a very important point, and ultimately we have the tension between local decision making and the government requiring, and it's a tension we wrestle with on. We discussed it as being material to the last petition, and we're discussing it again here as material to this petition on school libraries. I think there are the government sometimes. Well, we have to choose the ground upon which we make things a requirement, if I can put it as bluntly as that, and. We, if we make everything a requirement, then there is no room for local discretion and local decision making. I wouldn't want anyone to misconstrue what I'm saying. I think school libraries should have a prominent role in the life of the school. I think there are a tremendous, I can't conceive of how teachers will be able to adequately convey the importance of an appreciation of literature and an understanding of literacy without being able to exemplify that within a school library. And I think that's something that really is very important. But I have to be careful that I'm not over-prescribing to local authorities what I require them to do. But I certainly believe that this is a very important and significant aspect of what needs to be applied, and as we take forward the formulation of a national strategy for school libraries, we can perhaps wrestle with the issue that Mr. Whittle puts in front of me as to just how firm we should be on making some of these aspects of this debate a requirement.
Sorry. So, if I may, could I use the word then? Persuade. Can we, rather than implement, make a requirement? Is there a policy perhaps to strong persuade?
I think that's the. In a sense, that's the territory we're in about with a national strategy and with guidance. We're trying to exhort good practice and persuade good practice, to use Mr. Whittle's words. And then obviously, as with other issues, if we don't achieve satisfaction, then we can obviously consider requirement. But I think if we have, what I try to do in my work with local government, and it's perhaps not always perceived this way, is to try to encourage joint good practice between government and local government. And I would be surprised if local authorities were to marshal an argument saying that they don't think school libraries are a good thing. I'd be very surprised to hear that. Whether a due prominence is given to school libraries is perhaps a different matter.
I suppose this is the question, isn't it? This is COSLA set out its view that the creation of a national school library strategy would, quote, also further undermine the role of local elected councillors in making budget decisions and would be a further erosion of local democracy. And also the petitioner expressed disappointment at this comment. Do you think that having a national strategy does have that impact, or what are the mitigations? Because I think I agree with you that nobody's against libraries. Nobody's and the pressures that would come on you as a government minister to develop a national library strategy would be the same as the pressures on a local authority at a local level campaigner saying there should be libraries. So if we assume that nobody's malevolent in their hostility to libraries in this situation, what is the balance then round understanding why perhaps local authorities have not given the prominence to libraries that perhaps a national strategy would develop?
I think obviously there's a, as with all these questions, there'll be a range of different approaches taken around the country. I gave you an example, the committee example there of Elgin Academy, which is absolutely, the library is the epicentre of the school, and they view it so, and they couldn't make it more central to the life of the school. And then there'll be other examples where we know in Argyll and Bute there's been proposals to significantly reduce the school library provision within the local authority area. Now, I think a national strategy may be helpful because if I'm asked, do I think it's a good thing that school libraries start to get eroded? No, I don't think that's a good thing. I think that's a really bad thing, actually. And I've looked at the material that's come from the petitioner, and I've looked at the evidence, and that's why I gave the answer I gave to you in your first question, convener, that I think, and actually weighing this all up, we have to give clearer signals about what we expect. And this is where I come into my discussion with Mr. Whittle a moment ago, that it's a fine balance between me saying you must have a school library in every school, where I appreciate there may be practical challenges and issues and that go with that, particularly with the very wide and diverse geography that we have as a country. But there will be ways in which we can provide school library services in a sustainable way if we attach due priority to them. And I think what persuaded me for the need to have a national strategy in this respect is that I think we need to give a stronger signal than perhaps is being given in this respect, and I think the petitioner has prompted me to come to that conclusion.
Okay. And I mean, I think that again, probably in terms of this balance between local authorities and government, there is a balance around what priorities you make within the budget constraints you've got and to what extent you can have an impact on the budget constraints that perhaps have been created for local authorities as well.
Well, we were having a fairly harmonious morning until we got to 10:03. I thought I'm actually surprised. you will appreciate, convener, that I think local authorities have been fairly supported in the government settlement, and not least of which by the additional resources that were provided to local authorities by the budget agreement that was arrived at for 2017-18.
And I think you would also expect me to say would require some library skills to interrogate the actual view of the extent to which that budget process is one that everybody's happy with. But in terms of
I'd be quite happy to put my research gathering skills to the test, convener, with the index cards of the old Edinburgh University Library at my disposal.
Yep. We won't say what a good education wasted on, but there you go. Okay. Can I thank you very much for that. I think, again, there's been a lot of useful dialogue around this issue, and we know that the petitioners in particular are concerned that there's a kind of a reduction process around the role of a library. So I think they probably would get some comfort from that understanding of the broader role of the library and the professionals operating within the school library as well. In terms of action to take forward, again, I think it would be useful to reflect on the evidence from the Deputy First Minister with a note to the a future meeting of the Petition Committee. We can look at what further action we may take at that stage, and of course that will afford the petitioner the opportunity to respond to what has been said around the actual establishment of a national strategy. If that's agreed? Okay. If again, I can suspend until we change the Scottish Government officials. Okay, if we can bring the meeting back to order again, and we move to the next petition, which is petition 1603 on ensuring greater scrutiny, guidance and consultation in armed forces visits to schools in Scotland. The petition was lodged by Mairi Campbell-Jack and Douglas Beattie on behalf of Quakers in Scotland and Forces Watch. Copies of the petitioner's recent submission and correspondence from the Deputy First Minister have been circulated with the clerk's note on this petition. Accompanying the Deputy First Minister for this evidence session are Mairi Swinney, team leader, and Catherine McNab, policy advisor. As with the previous two petitions, we will move straight to questions from the committee, and perhaps again I can open up the questioning. Deputy First Minister, as you know, the committee has received a submission on the petition from Skills Development Scotland. In your submission, you note that Skills Development Scotland's career services, quote, are shaped by the Scottish Government's career information, advice and guidance strategy and the recent refresh of the youth employment strategy. You go on to say that they, quote, align with the recommendations of the Commission in developing the young workforce, so there is a range of existing guidance to ensure that careers advice is impartial and focused upon the individual's needs. As well as being impartial, do the various strategies support the provision of careers advice that presents a full and accurate picture of careers, such as outlining the possible risks as well as opportunities that may be represented by particular career choices?
That has to be the central requirement of a career service, to provide a dispassionate assessment on any career opportunity and how that would relate to the individual skills, interests, attributes and outlook of any young person interacting with the career service. So my answer would be yes to that, Convener.
Thank you. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. In some of the submissions we have received, references have made to the studies carried out by organisations such as MedAct and Combat Stress that consider the longer-term outcomes experienced by some who have joined the armed forces. How does the Scottish Government take into account such reports when reflecting on the issue of armed force visits to schools and ensuring that young people are supported to choose post-16 destinations that will enable them to fulfil their potential in the long run?
The key point, I think, is the one that the convener has raised with me and which lies at the heart of this petition, that in the careers information, advice and guidance, it is a requirement that advice is presented about all attributes of a particular career choice, the strengths, the weaknesses, the opportunities, the threats, and that is relevant to the perspectives, the interests, the attributes, and the experience of the individual young person that is seeking that advice. So there must be a tailored approach taken to meeting the needs of young people in relation to that advice, but also ensuring that that is done in a way that is truly dispassionate in making that assessment for young people.
I think the number of the matter here, really, from the petitioner, is that with any career opportunity, or somebody coming in to demonstrate a career opportunity, they will always try and make that career look as positive and as good as possible. And that's a given. Do you see within armed forces that there's an inherent issue there?
I'm not sure I agree with Mr. Whittle's presumption there. The inference of the question. My apologies. I didn't choose my words well there. Of the proposition there. Because going back to my first answer to the convener, careers advice has got to be dispassionate. It's got to give you the whole picture. What might be the excitement, but what might be the risk? I'd be interested to assess the careers advice that might have been given in my direction as to where I've ended up about the excitement and the risk relationship in all of that. But I think it's essential that careers advice is presented in that fashion, and that young people are then enabled. And of course, this is a core part of the purpose of curriculum for excellence, is to equip young people with the decision-making capability to be able to look at that, what is presented to them, and to say, well, I've weighed that all up, and that's right for me, and I've weighed that up, and that's wrong for me, and to make that judgment. So I think there's an obligation on the careers, and it's an implicit part of the careers information, advice and guidance, that it must be dispassionate, and it must present the whole picture. And that, therefore, enables young people to make their judgments about what is appropriate for them and what is not appropriate for them.
Thank you.
Can I just clarify then that you would expect in dispassionate careers advice around a career in the armed forces for somebody to highlight the issues that have been highlighted by MEDACT and combat stress around long-term consequences of being in the armed forces?
I would have thought that's fair material to be involved in that assessment, yes.
Thank you. I'll bring in after Rona Mackay.
Concerns have been expressed about the possibility of there being some targeting of schools, particularly in areas with higher rates of deprivation, and they've been allegedly receiving a disproportionate number of visits. Would that concern you if that was the case?
I think the first thing is that, for me to say, is that I have no information that supports that point, and it would be wrong of me to suggest otherwise. I've also seen the communication that the Ministry of Defence has shared with the committee on this point, and I have, and it makes clear that that approach is not taken. So I think it's the armed forces are part of the employment possibilities of young people in Scotland, but they are a part of them, and I think they have to be presented as part of that range of activities. You know, we've got a very good framework in place now through Developing Scotland's Young Workforce, which I think has been a fantastic piece of work that Sir Ian Wood produced for the government back in 2014. It's now being used very widely across the school system, with a lot of employer engagement and participation at local level, and that's helping to structure many aspects of our interaction between schools and the world of work. And of course, within the world of work, the armed forces will be part of that world of work and should be presented in that dispassionate way that I've talked about within that context.
Okay, just to follow on from that, you said in your answer that you weren't aware of areas being targeted particularly. Do you see a role for the government in collecting data? The petitioner is calling for this to ensure that there is a system so that you know that you could find out if this was the case. Is that a Scottish Government role?
Depends. What I'm through the Developing Scotland's Young Workforce activity, we are encouraging schools now to be much more engaged with the world of work, and I think we've not collected data so far on the existence or the substance of that activity. Obviously, we can give consideration to whether that would be appropriate, but I'm mindful of how much information we try to collect from all of our schools, given my general desire to reduce the volume of bureaucracy that we apply to schools. But ultimately, I think school leadership will make judgments about the interaction they have with the world of work and to make sure that's appropriate for the needs of their young people and to ensure it's presented effectively to in all circumstances.
Okay, thank you.
Edward Martin.
Swinney, can I just, before I say anything, just remind the committee that I was a soldier for 12 years and my son is still a serving soldier. So it may affect my questions, but Ms. Swinney, I wonder if you'd accept that soldiers today are actually very professionally trained and the costs of training them up to the standards that are required to deal with the equipment that they have and are issued with are considerably more than they were when I joined the army, and therefore there is a huge investment by the military in making sure they get the right person, and the right person then completes the training. So do you accept that the military actually have to make sure they get the right person rather than the quantity of people, and therefore they must make sure that the person is happy in their job, because there's no point taking somebody on, getting him through basic training and then advanced training for him to leave. They would look for a long career from that person, possibly a minimum of 6 years, probably more likely 12 or 22, which is a good career. Do you accept that that's the premise of where they're coming from and where they're starting from?
I think that would be a pretty fair point, yes.
Thank you.
Can I ask just on this question about the dispassionate approach around careers, and you would give information of what all the different options would be? One of the questions that's really flagged up by the petition is not just when the armed forces come in round a careers visit, but they come in round something to do with the curriculum, and very often the connection with the armed forces at a local level with a school won't be about careers, they're actually about affording other opportunities. Would that dispassionate approach be reflected in those kinds of visits as well? What kind of safeguards are there around those kinds of contacts with schools being kind of a softer contact, if you like, which doesn't deal with that dispassionate element that you've already highlighted?
Well, fundamentally, the judgment about points like that, which are different from the recruitment argument, are about the relevance to the curriculum. And this is where I'd perhaps follow up part of what Mr. Mountain raised with me. There will be elements of understanding the curriculum from a STEM perspective, for example, where there may be a relevance in how an issue can be understood through an example or exemplification involving something to do with the military. And but that would ultimately be a professional judgment for teachers to make about what would be an appropriate exemplification for a particular topic within the curriculum. And we rely on our teaching profession, particularly through Curriculum for Excellence, to come to that judgment as to what is an appropriate exemplification for aspects of the curriculum and to and to deploy that judgment as they see fit.
Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks. Convener, if I could turn to the issue of parental consent and with regard to involving pupils and parents or guardians in decisions about education, the question of consent has been addressed in the petition. We've received differing views about this, with the Children and Young People's Commissioner, Tam Bailey, being of the view that children and young people in secondary schools should be assumed as being capable of informed consent. However, the Scottish Parent Teacher Council stated that it believes any proposed armed forces recruitment activity must be subject to detailed consultation and the view of parents listened to and respected. Would you support the call for consent to be given in advance of any armed forces visit? And if so, do you see a role for the Scottish Government producing guidance in setting out the rights and responsibilities in this regard?
I think fundamentally the issues around where consent is secured must be carefully judged by individual schools. And that also relates, and I make that comment within the context of my belief, with which Parliament will be familiar, that schools should be involved in a very active process of parental dialogue on an ongoing basis on all issues. So I think I essentially would want to encourage an extensive and deep process of dialogue with parents within schools on a habitual basis. I think that's good for the school and it's good for the parental community. It creates strong, well-founded, well-supported schools. And as part of that dialogue, any issues of consent are most effectively resolved within that context. You do get into the complicating situation that once young people are 16, they are free to offer their own consent on these issues. And that becomes a more complicating factor in all of these questions. So I think the issue is best resolved at local level using through the established mechanisms of, not necessarily the established mechanisms, the encouragement of active parental involvement in the agenda of the school and in ensuring that at all times the school leadership is operating in an environment where it is seeking consent within the parental community.
Okay, thank you.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. I think hopefully we'd all agree that the armed forces should be seen as a very legitimate career and as potentially fulfilling as any other career. But it seems to me with the petitioner we need to square the circle here. And Together Scotland and the petitioners have suggested this is an issue that should be subject to a child's rights impact assessment. I wonder if that's something that you would consider commissioning.
I'm certainly very happy to consider that point and to see whether it such an approach should be taken. obviously, we have to weigh up, and we would have to weigh up in such a circumstance a whole range of different factors. But I'm certainly quite happy to give consideration to that point. Yeah.
Edward Mountain.
In previous evidence, a particular concern has been expressed about armed forces visits to special schools, and the petitioners call for an inquiry into this and whether it should be prohibited. Is this something you're aware of, and do you have any views on this prohibition?
I'm not aware of this at all, actually, so I would be interested if there was more detail the committee could share with me on that point. I'd be happy to hear that.
I'm not aware that it's undertaken either, but it's something that the petitioners have raised and therefore I was asked to ask.
If you can help me with that, I'd certainly be happy to explore that.
I mean, I suppose was it the last question I would want to ask you or ask you to reflect on is what is evident, I think, to the committee, the strength of feeling of the petitioners and the reassurance they are seeking that we're not in a position where vulnerable young people or young people who have fewer economic opportunities are disproportionately being drawn into a life in the armed forces without proper understanding of the consequence of that, simply because of their circumstances. It goes back to the question that Rona Mackay asked earlier about this idea that young people in poorer communities are targeted, that they're vulnerable to the lure, if you want to call it, of a life in the armed force. Now, I'm not suggesting I agree with any of this. If you want me to be the devil's advocate in this, then perhaps that's the way to put it. But I think that is, in essence, the concerns of the petitioners. I said at an earlier meeting that poverty is the greatest recruiting sergeant for the army. That is maybe a way in which it's been characterised in the past. How do you respond to that? I mean, I think we've had an interesting conversation about the measured way in which you'd want to deal with this, but I wonder how you respond to that the thing underpinning this petition, which is really quite strong from the petitioners, that there is an injustice here, or a potential exploitation here that I'm not suggesting the armed forces themselves would want to be party to, but they're sensed that this is happening. And how would you as a government respond to that, and do you have a role in addressing those kinds of concerns?
The first thing that I'd want to say, Convener, is that I quite understand the concern that's been expressed by the petitioners, and I think actually in general, I think, and this is, I think, one of the great strengths of this committee and this process, is that it's an opportunity for members of the public who are concerned about certain things to have the issue aired in an organised parliamentary fashion so that we can reflect on these points. And I have nothing but respect for the motivations behind all of the petitioners that come forward with a point of view. They've got them, they're citizens of our country, they're entitled to be heard and heard properly and with respect. I would, however, want to reassure them, and I've tried to do that by considering this issue within the context of what is our general approach to careers guidance. And the general approach to careers guidance is to make sure that when young people are engaging in careers advice, they're getting dispassionate advice, they're getting it all the ups and the downs, they're getting everything about it, and they can make their own judgment about it. And if I was to find that that wasn't the case, I would be deeply troubled about it. Because, and that's not just about an armed forces career, it's about anything, because young people need to be properly advised about the ups and downs of every particular career they might decide to take forward. So that's my first point, and it's my main point of reassurance that I hope helps in this discussion, because it highlights the fact that in all circumstances, no matter what career a young person is contemplating, they are entitled to that dispassionate assessment of its ups and downs. The second point is that, and I accept this is work in progress, but the whole thinking behind the government's agenda on education just now, which I think is widely supported in Parliament and within our local authorities and within the country, is on the attainment challenge. And at the heart of the attainment challenge is to make sure that every single young person in our country is able to fulfil their potential regardless of their background, so that poverty is not an inhibitor to that young person fulfilling their potential. Now, I stress it. I accept that's work in progress, but that's what we are driving to try to address, which I hope partly addresses the concern that somehow there is a predisposition for young people from deprived backgrounds to end up in the armed forces because it's the only option available to them, if I can put it as crudely as that. And then the final point is to then come back to Mr. Mountain's point to me about what the army and the military are looking for. That increasingly the armed forces are more recruiting by skill requirement than by volume requirement, if I can put it like that. So it's not just a case of a numbers game, it is about a range of people who can do certain things. And I think that changes some of the dynamics of this discussion. And out of all of that, I think there is an obligation on ministers like me to make sure that we are presiding over an education system that is able to fulfil the potential of young people and to equip them with the educational capability and the skills that then enable them to fulfil their potential as a consequence.
One of the recurring problems that the petitioners say they've had is obtaining information from the armed forces. And this goes back to my earlier question about data collection. Would you consider asking for a commitment from the armed forces to make accessible, good quality data available to the public or to the Parliament?
Very happy to do so. And, yeah, and if the committee wants to specify what it would think would help in this discussion, I'm very happy to make a request to the UK Government on that perspective. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
And just to reiterate a point I made earlier, I mean, I hear what you say around careers and the needs of the modern armed force as opposed to perhaps in the past. But there is this question about the way in which the armed forces now come into schools, which is not about careers. And in some areas, it may be that they can offer fun things to do that other groups and organisations can't offer. So they just, it's the kind of soft power, the soft attractiveness. We're doing interesting kind of team building type things with the armed force. And that, maybe suspicion is too strong a word, by the petitioners, around the way in which that becomes a gateway to recruitment. I'm not sure what, if you got a view on the guidance that you would offer to schools in that, but it may be something we can find out more from the Ministry of Defence on how they view that kind of role.
There's a, I think that's a slightly more difficult issue because we are generally, in our Developing Scotland's Young Workforce activity, encouraging schools to be much closer to the world of work. So having businesses and economic organisations, which would include the armed forces, much able to demonstrate what the world of work involves. So the overwhelming majority of school interaction with the world of work is not going to be with the armed forces. It's going to be with local companies and local organisations who are able to demonstrate what it's like to work in particular areas and to give work experience. And schools are now involved in much more systemic work experience activity, which for some young people on a pathway which is going to see them taking a more vocational route through school is going to, frankly, increasingly dominate that young person's journey through the education system. And we judge that to be a good thing. But that will be the very small minority that will be in relation to the armed forces. But I do accept the point, the convener, that you make, that that might be a sort of a softer introduction to the armed forces, but then it also might be a softer introduction to a chemicals firm or a softer introduction to a social enterprise provider. And it's just about how we manage that so that young people don't deduce the wrong impression from that. And that's a slightly more difficult thing for us to police when we're generally, and I think we're all agreed on this, exposing young people to the world of work and making that more seamless is a desirable policy objective.
Okay, I mean, I think, again, the petitioner makes the point that choosing a life in the armed forces brings with it more risk than perhaps in other careers, but they're not suggesting, I don't think we're suggesting as a committee in any way, that that wouldn't be a legitimate career choice for people. Brian?
I don't know if it's a question or a comment, really, that and I don't know the answer to this, and maybe that's something we can explore, but seems to me that the route to armed forces is really through cadets, because the armed forces have this gateway into full career by going through the Air Training Corps or the Army Cadets or whatever. And I wonder whether or not, I don't know the answer, whether or not we're looking at direct recruitment from schools is actually where the petitioner has an issue, and whether or not it's a bit of a red herring, because the real recruitment, it comes through the cadet process.
I think that the point that Ronan Mackay makes around data collection, that sense of what environment everybody's operating in relation to those kinds of visits, and it would be a useful conversation, I guess, to have with the Ministry of Defence. To what extent do they see the cadet as that kind of role, or indeed to make the case for them, having worked with young people who were involved with cadets, sometimes they were an opportunity to create a bit of space and energy in their lives, an opportunity they wouldn't have had otherwise, even just simply a structure in their lives that they wouldn't have had otherwise. But that's at the heart of the contention round, I suppose, some of what the petition says. Can I just thank the Deputy First Minister very much again for that? I think we've kind of come to the end of our questions and comments in the question, but I wonder whether what suggestions we have in terms of dealing with this petition.
Convener, I apologise if I should have made this sort of comment just slightly earlier. You know, when I joined up the army, I certainly knew the risks, and I think Mr. Swinney's right that the army, we must take cognizance of the fact that the army's dropped from 200,000 when I joined to 82,000. So it's looking for a very particular set of skills, and I'd like to reiterate the cost of training for each of those soldiers that goes through. So it's absolutely right and vital to get the right person, and therefore I think that actually saying that they're trying to get people who are looking for a way forward is the wrong way. And I would urge, and I think it's very good that Mr. Swinney's going to write to the department, the defence, and ask them. But I think something that may help the committee, and I sat the last time I think that the committee considered this, I think the committee should ask relevant people in Scotland to come and give evidence to the committee on what they do, and I see no reason why they wouldn't, and I think it would help the committee understand what they're trying to achieve with the teams that they send out. I personally don't think there's anything sinister in it, and I think they'd welcome the opportunity.
I think, just for information, the committee's in a process of taking up the offer of a briefing from the Ministry of Defence on how they see these matters arising, and from that briefing we can then make a number of decisions about how we report back to the committee in that. I think that the point is an important one. Can we suggest that we again reflect on the evidence of the Deputy First Minister? We ask the clerk to produce a report and we can look at that in terms of taking action, taking forward. Anything else, Rona? No? Okay, so we would agree, as we have done through the conversation, about how we want to take this forward, but we'll have a report to a further meeting. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister very much for his evidence on that petition, and indeed all three petitions today. I appreciate quite how busy a person you are, so three petitions worth of you is very much appreciated by the committee, and I'm sure the rest of your day is just a bit of a doddle in comparison. So can I thank you very much, and I'll allow a brief suspension for witnesses to leave. If we can call the meeting back to order and move to agenda item 2 on continued petition. The first continued petition we will consider is petition 1627 by Annette McKenzie on consent for mental health treatment for people under 18 years of age. Members will see we've received a number of submissions from a range of stakeholders, as well as the petitioner's response to the submissions received. There appears to be a consensus in the submissions received that the principle of patient confidentiality should remain unchanged, and there was no support, therefore, for the measures called for in the petition to change the processes for under-18s being able to consent to treatment for themselves. On the issue of guidance, there appears to be consensus that existing guidance is adequate. Notwithstanding this, the Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland, and the petitioner considered that it may be worth reviewing the guidance specifically on young people's mental health treatment. In this regard, the Scottish Association for Mental Health noted that its recent survey of GPs found that only 53% were aware of non-pharmacological approaches to depression. The Medicines and Healthcare Products Agency suggested in this regard that the committee may wish to seek more information from the Royal Colleges of Psychiatrists, Faculty of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. Other stakeholders, such as the Royal College of General Practitioners and the Scottish Youth Parliament, mentioned the benefits of social prescribing. The RCGP considered that the provisions of the Links Worker Programme, which is funded by the Scottish Government, is very beneficial in helping patients navigate services. However, we understand that the RCGP submission, from the RCGP submission, that only very few general practices are participating in the programme. The Scottish Government explained that the Chief Medical Officer is committed to review the consent process for people who receive care and support in Scotland. The Scottish Government advises that this review will include the issues raised by the petition, and the petitioner has noted her interest in participating in any discussions on the development of guidance in this area. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action. Brian?
I think the evidence we took from the petitioner was very moving, and it actually throws up for me a much wider issue in terms of how do doctors assess people presenting with mental health issues. How do they assess their ability to then follow a process of medication themselves? And that's something I've wrestled with quite a lot. And so I know that this is a bit under 18s, and I appreciate that. And I'm looking at the SAMH suggesting that with the NICE guidance that on social anxiety in children and young people said that they should not offer medication, but instead not usually offer medication, but should be offered cognitive behavioural therapy. For me, I'm just wondering, within a 15-minute consultation, how does a doctor assess a patient's ability in these circumstances to follow that medication? And I don't know the answer to that, and I think that's something I would really want to try and explore further.
Mm-hmm. I think the difficult thing for the family to come to terms with was the fact if they had known, they would have understood the change in behaviour and would have been able to be supportive. And actually, well, there are two things, isn't it? It's the fact that she had was taking the tablets, but it was the tablets that then she used as a means of killing herself, which is just, it's beyond bearing, it's beyond belief. And I think I understand why the issue of consent was the one that was focused on. Understand that the general good is not that it's a breach of confidentiality, but that this question of what is the guidance to GPs, I mean, I'm astonished the 53% of GPs would not be aware of non-pharmacological approaches. Yes, I find that astonishing.
Me too.
But the other question there arises is that, is it within in the GP's remit to be able to say to the patient or suggest to the patient that it's in their best interest if another member of the family or close to them is brought into that sort of that circle. I don't know if that's within the GP's remit.
I think it's something would be worth exploring further. I think I said before, hearing a report on, I think it was either House of Lords or House of Commons committee, which said that while they understood the issue of confidentiality, the GP could bring into the conversation, would it be helpful or it would be useful for you to have somebody that you trust to be involved in your care around this medication. So it's not that you breach confidentiality, but it's part of your guidance that you would ask that question.
Mm-hmm. Is this using your judgment as to...
Yeah, because not all young people will have bad relationships with their parents.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And actually, if it's suggested to them and they think there's not a stigma involved in me admitting this to my family, with the GP's encouragement, they might have done that.
That's right.
And I'd be interested to know what actually is the guidance to a GP around first visits, first time somebody presents reporting to have mental health issues. What's the guidance around moving to a medical prescribing response as opposed to some of the social prescribing that's been suggested?
Also, going on from that, it would then be if guidance exists, evidence is being presented to us that guidance is obviously not filtering through to the front line, and how that process then can be, taken forward.
One of the actions or suggestions is that we contact the Royal College of Psychiatrists Faculty of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry's view on the petition and ask about the clinical guidelines for mental health conditions in children and adolescents. This is beyond most of our comprehension, what has happened here, and I think it is an absolutely huge issue which we have to explore as much as we can. We should also seek clarification from the government on how the petitioner could contribute to the review, which she's wanting to do. I think that's fundamental that she's able to do that. And then possibly further down the line, maybe ask for the Minister for Mental Health to come and give evidence once we've got through the first stage, perhaps.
Yeah. I think these are very positive suggestions. I wonder, this question of what actually are the guides. I think you make an important point. What are the guidelines? And to understand where you can utilise a family as a support to a young person. And one of the questions I would ask is, I'm aware that you will not routinely be prescribed antibiotics, even if you go and ask for them. You're told, no, it's because of the consequences. Or indeed, in my lifetime, Valium at one point would have been routinely prescribed. It isn't now. So presumably doctors are in a position where they can say, well, perhaps you're asking for tablets, but we're not going to give you them because we don't think it's in your interest. So how does this filter through in terms of this kind of issue?
Perhaps there should be an exemption. I mean, I know, I understand the confidentiality issues and consent issues, but given that the ethos in mental health now is that it's talked about, it's not something that should be, a sort of hidden illness. In this instance, the whole family could have helped if they had known that's what she was being prescribed and that's what was happening. So I think, that's something we could explore later, maybe with the minister. Is this an example where maybe it should be an exemption when it comes to mental health?
I think I understand and indeed worked with young people who were not able to talk to their families, and perhaps the families were the cause of their problems, but in circumstances where it must be possible for the GP to at least, or would it be possible to test that question with a young person, because it's not that they don't think their families would be supportive, but by the nature of mental health issues, they perhaps feel as if they've let their families down by even having to say they've got this problem.
When Mrs Mackenzie gave evidence was that her daughter wasn't asked if she minded if, surely the GP could say, do you mind if I ask your parent or tell your parents about this? And that would be a form of consent then that the young person would give. But I don't think that was even asked.
Especially if it's followed up with a reassurance, this is nothing to be ashamed of. These are things that happen to young people, that happen to adults. Your mum and dad, your family would want to be supportive of you.
Help.
Mm-hmm. Well, understanding that for some young people that's not going to be the case, but at least testing that with a young person.
But in both cases, I would have thought family support is absolutely critical to getting to a sensible solution.
Completely.
Mm-hmm. And certainly the experiences I've had in this situation would suggest that leaving the family out is actually making the problem worse. So I would have thought I agree, Convener, with what you're saying, is that it should be part of the doctor's procedure to ask whether families should be included and to make it a positive suggestion rather mm-hmm. than a negative suggestion.
Yeah.
So I would agree with your proposal that you made earlier.
So are we agreeing then? We write to Scottish Government to clarify how Alison Mackenzie can be involved or contribute to the review of the consent process for people who receive care and support in Scotland. And we're interested. And this question of the funding for the provision of Linked Workers Programme. I think the Linked Workers Programme is for the depend surgeries, so it's surgeries in some of the most vulnerable communities where people present with a whole range of issues, so I'm not sure whether it would have applied through the current procedures for the family involved, but it would be worth knowing whether that kind of model is something they're looking at rolling out. To write to the Royal College of Psychiatrists, Faculty of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, to get their view on the petition. And I think to flag up, as Rona Mackay suggested, potentially getting the Minister in at a later stage. That's agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. If we can then move on to petition 1628, consultation in the service delivery for the elderly or vulnerable. This petition 1628 by Maxwell Barr on behalf of Struan Lodge Development Group and Dunoon Community Council and concerns consultation and service delivery for the elderly or vulnerable. We've received written submissions from Audit Scotland, Scottish Health Council, the Scottish Government and COSLA. The petitioner has also provided his views on the submissions received. Audit Scotland and the Scottish Health Council raised concerns that the existing guidance could cause confusion about lines of accountability and decision-making. In this regard, the Scottish Health Council states that it firmly believes that the Chief Executive Letter 4th of 2010 guidance and a supplementary guidance on identifying major health service changes should be reviewed and revised. The petitioner supports this point of view. COSLA explained in its written submission that it does not consider any further guidance or consultation requirements are needed. The Scottish Government has explained it has no plans to update Chief Executive Letter 4th of 2010 guidance. Members will see from the Clerk's note that the Health and Sport Committee is currently conducting an inquiry into integration authorities' consultation with stakeholders. I understand the petitioner has made a submission to the inquiry and the committee will take further oral evidence on the inquiry shortly. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action. Angus?
Thanks, Camina. I think given the, as you've mentioned, the petitioner has made a written submission to the Health and Sport Committee's scrutiny on engagement with the public and the third sector. And given that the Health and Sport Committee is due to consider this inquiry again, I believe, next week, I think we should refer the petition to them without any delay.
Okay, do we have any other views? there is something of an impasse in terms of, you know, the Health Council saying it does need to be revived, the Scottish Government saying they're not going to look at it further, COSLA saying it's not necessary. There's obviously a whole big question there, and I think if it's part of the Health Committee's work, that would usefully be interrogated there, and it doesn't necessarily need to be duplicated by us. So if we're agreed, we're going to refer the petition to the Health and Sports Committee. Okay. Thanks very much for that, and of course we'd want to thank the petitioners and all those who contribute in response to our requests for further information. And the last petition we want to deal with, the next petition is petition 1639 by Mairi McMillan on Enterprise Agency Boards. We last considered this petition at our meeting on 30th of March, and members will recall that the Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Jobs and Fair Work was due to make a ministerial statement on the Enterprise and Skills Review later that afternoon. The Cabinet Secretary explained that Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the other agencies will be retained with their existing powers. More information in the statement is set out in the Clerk's note. And I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions for action. The only point I would make is that also we've not asked the petitioner for a response to the statement by the Scottish Government, and I wonder whether it would be worth asking for that. It looks as if clearly that the Cabinet Secretary has responded to the pressures and concerns that have been on a cross-party basis highlighted, but particularly about the role of HIE, but I wonder whether it would be worth, before we close the petition, we actually ask the petitioner for a view.
If we ask the petitioner if the Cabinet Secretary's response actually is adequate for what she's asking for.
Is that agreed? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. In that case, we're agreeing to contact the petitioner for her response to a statement made by the Scottish Government subsequent to her appearance at the committee, and we'll not say it as a consequence of her appearance to the committee. And we can obviously come back and reflect on her response at that point once we've received that. With that decision, can I thank members for their attendance and close the meeting.